Take your Bibles for our scripture reading and turn to James chapter number 4. James chapter number 4. And we're going to turn there. We're going to read one scripture there and then turn back to Genesis chapter number 13 and read a few scriptures there. James chapter number 4. We'll begin in James chapter number 4. Let's all stand once you find that. And in honor of God's word, let's read that. And I'm going to read that out loud, verse number 14 and verse number 15. Then we're going to read verse number 15. We'll repeat that verse. That'll be one of our text verses. We'll read that together. James chapter number 4 and verse number 14. Just read along silently as I read verse 14 and 15. The Bible says this, "Whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that." Let's read verse number 15 together. James chapter number 4 and verse number 15. Let's read that together. Ready? Begin. "For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that." Now turn over to Genesis chapter number 13. Genesis chapter number 13, and this is going to be our main portion of scripture for this evening. Genesis chapter number 13, and we're going to read starting in verse number 9. Let's go up to verse number 8. Let's go up to verse number 1. No, let's go up to verse number 8, and we'll start there. Genesis chapter number 13 and verse number 8. The Bible says this, as follow along as I read. "And Abraham said unto Lot, Let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. Is not the whole land before thee?" Look at that question mark. "Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. If thou depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plains of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere, before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, as thou comest to Zorah. Then Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves, the one from the other." In our text verse, our main text verse, will be verse number 9. "Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself." Here it is. You ready? "I pray thee from me, if thou wilt take the left hand, then I'll go to the right. If thou wilt depart to the right hand, then I'll go to the left." A great truth here in understanding an example of Abraham and what his decision here. We're going to talk about that this evening. Let's pray. We'll have a special, and then we'll get into the message. Dear God, I pray that you bless this evening. God, thank you for always, always taking care of us more than what we deserve. And God, I pray that you'd help this message this evening to be a help to us in our Christian life and our personal decisions that we make, but also as a church. God, I pray that you bless this music. Be with Pastor and our people as their way. Keep them safe. Bring them back safely to us. God, we love you, and we look forward to meeting with you this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Arms stretched open wide, barely hanging on to life. Left to suffer all alone. You came for all mankind to bridge the great divide. Somehow ended up alone. Because of all the blood and tears you shed, I will never know that kind of loneliness. Your spirit never leaves me, even when I'm hurting. I don't have to bear that burden on my own. You carried all the pain and buried all the shame when you made that rugged tree your righteous throne. Because of you, I'll never walk alone. You came here as a man. I know you understand what it's like to walk these roads. My problems don't compare to that crown you had to wear. Still, you take them as your own. Because of all the blood and tears you shed, I will never know that kind of loneliness. Your spirit never leaves me, even when I'm hurting. I don't have to bear that burden on my own. You carried all the pain and buried all the shame when you made that rugged tree your righteous throne. Because of you, I'll never walk alone. You carried all the pain and buried all the shame when you made that rugged tree your righteous throne. Because of you, I'll never walk alone. Lord, because of you, I'll never walk alone.
Turn your Bible to James chapter number 4. James chapter number 4. And Noah, you look sharp tonight, man, we match. Think about that. You want to get up here and preach? No? Okay. And we're matching tonight. And we even got blue ties on and a white shirt. Man, you're starting out right. Look at that. White shirt and everything. And there. So your mom must have dressed you because it matches. Amen. And right? No? No? Oh, no? Okay. And there. So Miss Miller, I got to pick on you real quick. She this morning was wondering how short it was going to be. Well, tonight, it's going to be real short. I only got 2 pages of notes, but my wife says that's dangerous. You always have been, but when it comes to preaching, that's a different story. Yeah, exactly. And I hope to be a help to you this evening. James chapter number 4. I want to say a quick thank you to my friend here over the last 6 years, I believe, but Brother Cordry. For all that he has done for our church. We say, you know, the staff really took care of things. I'm not here every day anymore. And so he has taken care of things since Pastor's been gone, and I appreciate him for that and thank him for that. And I really do, out of a lot of people, I look up to him there and his wisdom that God's given him at his age and in the way that God has used him. And I really do look up to him in that area, in those areas of his life that God's used him. And so I thank you, Brother Cordry, for taking care of things for Pastor. And the list just keeps getting longer. And so here's the school. Hey, here's the church. And I appreciate his willingness and friendship and commitment to God in all that he does. And so James chapter number 4, thank you, Pastor, for the opportunity. They're watching. this morning. And Brother Gio said, yes, they are watching, so watch what you say. And I saw that. He said all that, Pastor. And Giovanni's up there, Gio Jr. He's up there just nervous that he keeps everything going because they're watching. And there, so when something goes wrong, he gets a text. And there, so he's in communication with the higher power. The powers that be are ordained of God, brother, so you better be careful. There, James chapter number 4. We read a verse here, a well-known verse. And I'm going to read it here in a second. But well-known verse. I'm not going to preach on this. I want to take a thought from here. But well-known verse, we've heard it all the time. We've talked about it. We've heard sermons on it. Whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow. Okay, now we understand that life is but a vapor. It says it right here. Life's but a vapor. And boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what's going to happen down the road. And no matter how we live our life, we talked about it this morning, no matter how we live our life, we really do not know what's going to take place tomorrow. So in ways, we do have to walk by faith and not by sight, because we cannot see tomorrow. We know it's going to come. As long as the Lord doesn't come back, it should come there. That's kind of the only thing we can depend on, is that tomorrow is going to be here, but we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what we're going to face tomorrow. I don't know what's going to change tomorrow. Okay, and so this verse here goes on to say, for life is but a vapor, it appeareth for a little time, and then vanisheth away. For that we ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. And that verse there is a great verse to think about in your life personally, and in the truth that we're going to pull out this evening, that no matter what the Lord allows in your life, you ought to be willing to say, God, if you allow this, I'll do that. I'll do this. If you allow that, I'll do that. God, whatever you allow, I'm willing to do this or that. God, whatever you place in my life, I will accept it where I am at and accept what you have allowed in my life and be willing to go forward and do what you want, no matter what comes in my life. And a lot of Christians, we allow the struggles of life or things that would non-expected things in life to face them. And when we face them, we decide, well, that's not my schedule. That wasn't what I planned. That wasn't, God, what I thought you were going to do. That wasn't what I thought that you had for me. And that's not what the idea that I had. And it throws us, and if we're not careful, it throws us for a spin. I'm all for organization, and I'm all for planning, and I'm all for trying to do things right. And the Bible says, let all things be done diligently, decently, and in order. God's very much a God of order. Everything he created in order. Everything that he did in order. He has a purpose behind everything that he does. God has their seasons. God has seasons for a reason. God has time for a reason. There's a time for everything. There's a purpose for everything. We know that from Ecclesiastes chapter number 3. God has his time and a season for everything. So God has purpose behind everything. But in our life, we have to be willing to say, God, I don't understand your purpose, but God, whatever you place in my life, I will accept that in my life and continue to go on serving you. As much as we want to plan, we have to be willing to accept what God brings our way. That's the hard part. Some of us, we don't know what to do when something does not go as planned. We plan, we schedule, we get everything organized, and then something steps in the way that we did not expect, and when it happens, we go, oh no, I don't know what to do. And that's what we do. By the way, that's an illustration of what we do in life. Okay, God, I'm going to serve you. Okay, God, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And you get going along this road called life, and then something takes place that you did not expect. It could be a death in the family. It could be a sickness, an illness, something you can't get rid of. It could be a wayward child. You didn't expect that. You grew up in church. You taught them right. You made sure they were in church. You made sure they heard God's word. You made sure. But all of a sudden, they go astray. You didn't expect that. Your dreams, mom and dad, were that they'll grow up in church and they'll serve God and they'll go on to serve God the rest of their life. And there's someone that you can say, man, I'm proud of them and what they're doing and how God's using them. Someone you can look up to. But it didn't happen. Maybe it's a friend. He thought, friends forever, high schoolers, right? We're going to be best friends forever. And a week later, they're not friends anymore. And the next week, they are friends again. And it goes back and forth. And but friends forever, I was thinking our high schoolers, that are, none of them are here in church tonight. They're in Honduras. So, well, most of them. Where's
Okay, she's in nursery. And there. So, you know, oh, he's up. We kicked him out of the service. He has to stay upstairs. And high schoolers, right? They're all these friends that they have. They graduate. It would be amazing for them to be able to be around each other the rest of their lives in the ministry. Oh, that would be the goal. That'd be the dream. Probably not going to happen. Now, if it does, that's great. I have friends I went to high school with still serving God in churches. So back where they're supposed to be. I got a cousin that is assistant pastor back home in Florida. Man, I'm blessed to have someone like that in my life. But it doesn't always happen that way. I remember when I graduated high school, went off to college. It was literally me and my sister went to the same college, and then it was two of my friends from high school went to the same college. A year later, my cousin and my other sister came to the same college, and it was like, man, we got the Calvary Baptist Church clan all moving to the same college, and we enjoyed time together. But guess what? That didn't last. People started going their own way. It was fun. It was enjoyable. But life kind of took its turn. And there's decisions that had to be made. The Lord will I live and do this or that? Whatever God wants, will I just decide to serve Him? We get in this mentality of, we talk about the will of God. Let's stop there for a second and talk about that. We talk about the will of God. We hear preachers talk about, you got to find the will of God. And we have young people come to me, these teenagers that just graduated. And it's been a year or 2 years. It's been, Brother Pledger, what is the will of God? I don't know the will of God. You got to find out for yourself. Well, you're great help. You know what? I came to you to ask, I don't know the will of God for your life. I know direction and principle, and I can help push you and kind of lead you in that direction. That's something you have to decide. But when the will of God, what you think the will of God is, doesn't work out, what do? When you say, I think the will of God is to do this the rest of my life, and then God says, nope, not going to. I think of many pastors that I know that God, I mean, they gave themselves to God. They gave themselves to be used of Him. God used them. They were a pastor of a church, and God was blessing. God says, and then something happened in the family, and now they're divorced. They can't pastor anymore. I mean, talking about a life-changing thing. What I believe God's will was for my life just completely got taken off the table. Now what do I do? See, all of these decisions come to you eventually. Eventually, you as an individual Christian are going to have to make the decision, if the Lord will I live and do this or that? Not just one thing, but whatever God puts my way, will I just say, I'm going to do that. Whether it's something I think I want or something that God wants, I'm willing, God, to be led of you wherever you lead me. I'm willing to be led and do this or that. Now let's go to our text verse. Go over to Genesis chapter number 13. Not a good start, Ms. Miller. None of that was in the notes. Genesis chapter number 13. Genesis chapter number 13. We see here a story of Abraham, later to be called Abraham. We see in verse number 1, it says, verse number 1 of chapter number 12, it says, now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house and unto a land that I will show thee. Understand, God did not tell him exactly where to go. God said, I'll show it to you, just go. I will show it to you. Just go. Remember, walk by and not by sight. He told Abram, he said, listen, Abram, I'm going to use you. You get away from your country, get away from your family, and go into the land that I will show you. I'm not going to show it to you yet, but I'm going to show it to you eventually. By the way, we go over to chapter 13, and finally, God shows him what he has planned. A whole chapter later, after all this other stuff takes place. And so look in chapter 13, we see here it says, and Abram went up out of Egypt, verse number 1, he and his wife and all that he had and Lot with him into the south. And Abram was very rich in cattle and silver and in gold. And he went on his journeys from the south, even to Bethel, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning between Bethel and Hai. Under the place of the altar, which he had made there at the first, And there Abram called on the name of the Lord. And Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks and herds and tents. And the land was not able to bear them. It was too small of a land. Too many people, too much cattle, too many herdmen, too much. And the land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together. For their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdmen of Abram's cattle and the herdmen of Lot's cattle, and the Canaanite and the Perizzite. Dwelled in the land. And Abram said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. So we see here that understanding, now backing all the way up to God telling Abraham to leave, God told Abraham to leave thy family, but he also brought Lot. Now we understand that. By the way, understand this about the Bible. There is not just, in a lot of Scripture, there is not just one example that you can pull out of Scripture, but there's many examples and many truths that you can pull out. None of them contradict doctrine. Understand that. Nothing contradicts doctrine. But you can look at, you've heard sermons from the same verses and different sermons from the same verses. Why? Because God gives a truth. Have you ever read a verse as a young Christian, and then years later you read that verse again and God helps you with something else? See, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. And sometimes it's profitable for reproof. Sometimes it's profitable for correction and instruction. Sometimes it's profitable for doctrine. Sometimes God uses it in different ways in your life in whatever you are in at that time. So we see here that God told Abram to leave your family, leave your country, and go to a place I will show you. Now, of course, he brings Lot with him. Then we see later on in Scripture that God continues. By the way, God continues to bless. Understand, they had a very little when they left compared to what they had in the Scripture. He was rich with gold, silver, cattle, herds, all these things. But Lot also had a lot. Understand that sometimes, understand this about life, that sometimes we have to be careful. We talk about when it comes to our faith, that we have to be careful living off of somebody else's faith in God. Understand that God always blesses a man. In a church, that would be the pastor. God uses a man. God used Moses. He uses a Joshua. He uses an Abraham. God uses a man. And understand, sometimes just being around, if you will, that man, you receive blessings from God. And how many people, let's bring it down to level here. How many people even leave a good church? Yeah, God's blessed me and God's always taking care of me, so I'm going to leave and do my own thing. And they leave and all of a sudden they go, where are the blessings of God go? Why don't I have the blessings anymore? Could it be because the blessings that you received was more because of what God was doing in a place? Not you personally. Now, that should challenge us to say that I want my personal walk with God to be just as strong as anybody else's. That should challenge us. Because the truth is, we should not be living off of somebody else's faith. We should be living on our own faith. We should not be living off of somebody else's blessings, but the blessings that God gives us because of what we do for Him and how much we rely on Him. See, all these truths that you can learn from God's Word as you read and understand God's Word. So we see here that they get to a point. Abram said, this is not working. The land's not big enough for us. Think about how much God had blessed them. The land. It's not like they had a lot, right? A lot. Well, you did have a lot. But not like they had a lot here in Columbus, right? We only have this much faith. The land. Is not the whole land before thee? And it wasn't big enough for the both of them. I want you to think about how the blessings of God in that. It was not big enough for the both of them. I mean, they didn't have property lines. They didn't have all those things. There was no zoning like the city of Columbus does. The whole land was before them. And God had blessed them so much. He said, this is not going to work. We're getting to the truth here. So finally, Abraham says, Lot, this is not going to work. We've got to go our separate ways. By the way, one of the best things that could probably ever happen to Abraham was this departing. The splitting up, if you will. best things that could have happened to Abram. Sometimes the best things that can happen to you is to split ways with old friends. Sometimes it's even family. Because God wants to use you in a specific way, but something's holding you up. And sometimes it's one of the hardest decisions you can make, but you've got to make that decision. God bless my Nana, I won't call her Grandma. We have too many grandparents. And I can't keep all the names straight on who's who. But my Nana, when 2017, I was, chapter number 12 was the portion of scripture my father, my papa was preaching from there in Florida. And I remember sitting there, I slipped into church and was running late from work and it was on Wednesday night. It was on a Wednesday night and he was preaching along. And right in the middle of the service, God spoke to my heart. It's clear as day. And he said, Ryan, it's time for you to move. You're not going to. I had never in my life thought about leaving Florida, Middleburg, Florida. Never even crossed my mind. It wasn't even a question. And it was clear as day that God said, I'm moving you. And in that, it was like, okay, God, what does this mean? Now, for about 2 or 3 months, I kind of like, that was just an emotional thought. It would come back. It would become more of a thought even throughout the day. Ryan, I'm going to use you and I want to move you. I don't know where it's going to be at. I got a will for you and I want you to do something. I don't know what that is. And so I started finally, I gave in to God and just said, okay, God, whatever you want to do, I'll do it. It's evident that this is what you have. I don't know what it is, but evident that we are moving. I don't know where, don't know how. I had no idea it was going to be up north. So it's a far country. But he was moving us. And I remember all that was going on. We came to Your Faith Hard. We went back. My grandfather, of course, or Papa there, he, are you sure? Are you sure? Are you sure this is what God wants? And what if we hired you? And I was like, no, Papa, I think this is what God wants. I remember my Nana and all of her wisdom and all of her just being Nana. She walked up to me. And she said, Ryan, she has a major southern accent. Ryan, don't you let your pawpaw talk you out of doing what God wants. I remember my pawpaw was standing right there. And he goes, Barbara. And she goes, one of the best things that could ever happen to you is you leave this place. That's family. That's home. That's comfortable. Years later, my Nana has reminded me of that comment. And she's reminded me, Ryan, look what God has done in your life. Because you just simply obeyed Him and separated yourself. Abram was coming to this point in his life. He didn't understand that. But it was getting to the point where it's like, we got to separate. We've got to, this is what God wants. I cannot be used of God till we make this decision. That's where Abraham was. Understand, up to this point, God had not told him, I'm going to make the sea, your seed like the sand of the sea and the stars of the air. You're going to be blessed and your children are going to be my people. He hadn't told him that yet. At this point, it was just go and do what I'm telling you to do. He hadn't told him his plans for him yet. And until there was this dividing between him and Lot, God did not reveal his plan for him. And sometimes, listen to me, sometimes, Christian, the thing that's holding you up is something that you love dear. The thing that's holding you up can easily just be family. It can just be something that is not really wrong, but it's just not what God wants for His will. It's not what God wants for His will. Sometimes, listen to this, right? Sometimes it's a job. When the job starts taking you away from God's will, is it the right job? Is it hindering God's will for your life? Is it hindering God's purpose for your life? A family, a location, whatever it may be, God wants to use you in specific ways. And sometimes we get in the way of what God wants to do by just holding on to things that we don't need to hold on to. Now let's look at the next verse. Here's the sermon. That was still all extra, Miss Miller. In verse number 9, Abraham makes a decision and makes a statement that ought to be our mentality in every decision that we face in life. Listen to what he says here. He says, "Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me." Ready? Here it is. "If thou wilt take the left hand, then I'll go to the right. And if thou wilt take depart to the right hand, then I'll go to the left." Abraham was saying, "Lot, you choose. But whatever you choose, I'm still serving God. You decide, but whatever you decide, this or that, left hand or right hand, I'm still doing what God told me to do, and I'm still following God." And every Christian has got to have this mentality in life that whatever I face, whether it's the right hand or the left hand, God, whatever decision I have to make, I'm still serving God no matter what. A lot of Christians, and a lot of young Christians especially, get faced with that first problem in life. And instead of saying, "Okay, I'm being pushed this way in life, but I'm going to continue to serve God," they give up. "So I can't handle the pressure. That's not what I had planned. That's not what I saw God doing. That's not God. I thought you were going to take care of me this way, and now you're not taking care of me." They get this mentality of, "I got to have my way, or with God, it's not the right way." God says, what if I want you to go here? And then what if I choose for you to do this? What if I use you in this ministry and then a year later I say, "You know what? I want you to be working this ministry now." What if God says, I want you to be used this way at our church, but then next year God says, "You know what? It's time to grow out of that. I want to go you over here." See, we have our own idea of what God wants for us. And a lot of times, ready? Here's something I want you to think about. A lot of times, our decision is not made on God's will. It's made on our comfort. Abraham said, "Lot." He knew what he was looking at, by the way. The well-watered plains of Jordan. He said, "Lot, whatever you choose, I'll do." Now, there's another example in there that we're going to talk about here in a second. But Lot, whatever you choose, I'll do. Lot, Abraham could have said, "Lot, I'm going to choose a place that you're going to go the opposite." But no, Abraham said, "I'm serving God no matter what. Lot, you choose. Left hand or right hand. I'll go wherever you go. I'm still going to go serve God. Whether I get, ready? Whether I get the well-watered plains of Jordan or I get the opposite, I'm still going to serve God. Whether I get the blessings that I see or the blessings I don't see, I'm still going to serve God. Whether I see my direction and see everything's clear as day what God's going to do, or I have no idea what God's going to do, I'm just following one step at a time, wondering, God, where are you taking me, God? How are you going to bless me, God? How are you going to take care of me? Either way, I'm still serving God no matter what." Abraham could not make a decision on his comfort. He had to make the decision on God's will for his life. Right hand or left hand? Doesn't matter to me. I'm serving God either way. Right hand or left hand, Lot? No matter to me. I'm serving God either way. Abraham decided, no matter which way that this went, I'm still doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm still following. When God said, "Leave your country and leave your family and fall, go to a land that I have for thee," I'm following Him. In whatever situation comes my way, this is paramount. Whatever situation comes into my life, this is key. This is what I continue. This is what I don't stop, and that's following Jesus Christ. Abraham left home. He left comfort to serve God. He left what he knew. He left those he loved. Abraham came to a crossroad in his life, and there he had to make the decision of where he would go. Understand that Lot, the Bible says, chose the well-watered plains of Jordan. Lot was more concerned about himself and his needs and his wants, his monetary things, the well-watered plains. He looked over and saw the well-watered plains. I'll take that. Lot was more concerned. By the way, and it shows a difference in spirituality between Abraham and Lot. Abraham was not concerned about the well-watered plains or the desert. I'm just going to serve God either way. But Lot said, no, 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 I want the well-watered plains. I want the best. I'm going to take that. And in reaching for the best, listen to me, he lost everything. Lot literally went and pitched his tent towards Sodom. By the way, understand, when he pitched his tent towards Sodom, he was not doing wrong at that moment. But it eventually led to the destruction of his family. Listen to me, parent. Listen to me, adult. You pitch your tent towards the world, you might not be falling in it yet, but it's coming. When you look at it long enough, eventually you'll be there. You watch it long enough, eventually you'll get there. You desire it and kind of look over the fence at the greener grass on the other side, eventually you'll be over there. Eventually you'll be over there. Lot chose the well-watered plains. So what was Abraham saying? Decision. To the right or to the left, I'll serve God no matter what. So what examples can we learn from this lesson? What examples can we learn from this lesson? Number one, stay in tune with God. You've got to stay in tune with God. When you are faced with a problem in life, you cannot decide, what do I feel like today? You've got to decide, I'm serving God no matter where I go. When I graduated college, colleges are notorious for this. Notorious for a lot of things. But they're notorious for this, right? They pump you up, right? Nothing wrong with that. I think everybody ought to be encouraged. But I think sometimes we try to decide the will of God for people instead of letting God decide. So there's that. Bible College is notorious for, you know, your senior year, right? You're graduating. You're finishing up. What church are you going to pastor? What great thing are you going to do for God? So I can put that mark on our college. We have 15 pastors around the world. And it's a number, right? And where are you going to go? What great thing are you going to do? Are you going to go full time? Are you going to pastor a church? There's churches everywhere that need pastors, and we have been lined up to go be pastors at churches everywhere. This is the mentality. I remember when I was graduating college that it was like, you know, we get phone calls every other day of people needing pastors. There's no doubt this is true. Of people needing pastors and needing workers in churches. And so will it be you? You want to draw, you know, ticket out of the hat and decide where you're going to go? You know, but it was like, you know, flip a coin. What church do you want to go to? Where do you want to go? My mentality of going to college was always, I'm going to college to learn and go back home. I'm not going to college to stay, and I'm not going to college to do my own thing. I'm going to learn, go back where God brought me from, to my home, and continue to serve God. That was always my mentality. I understand in Bible college, and I'm encouraging parents that are like, oh, great. In Bible college, it's like 70% of Bible college students that go to Bible college never leave that college campus. In that church. They move there. By the way, just at Calvary alone, in a 3-year period of time, we lost 4 families moving to a Bible college, church that had a Bible college where their kids were at. And only one of those families are still in church. See, these decisions we make, we don't think about what we're doing. We don't think about what does God want. We think about what's comfortable for us. I want to be near my kids. I would just say leave them and let them go. But I want to be near my kids, and so we're going to move and go here. And pretty soon, they're nowhere to be found. They're nowhere to be found. I remember being asked constantly, what are you doing when you graduate? Where are you going when you graduate? You know, if you think God wants you to pastor, I've got a list of churches that you can choose from. Like it's drawing a ticket. Like it's flipping a coin. Like it's a lottery or something. I don't know what they were thinking, but it was like, well, no, I'm going back home, sir. And when I would be asked that question, here was my mentality. Well, what if that here's the question. What if that is not God's will for your life? I said, then God will show me his will. Listen to this. God will show me his will. But what are you going to do when you get there? I'm going to get busy serving God just like I would anywhere else. I don't serve God. Listen to this, ready? I don't serve God just because I know I am in his will. I serve God even when I'm waiting for his will. I serve God when I'm growing to learn what he wants me to do. It's a missionary saying this. We're going to go soul winning. We're going to start churches. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. But then you say, okay, well, soul winning time. You're going to be there? No, I don't go soul winning when I'm here in the States. So how are you going to do that on the mission field if you're not going to do it here? Right? Your mentality ought to be wherever I'm at, wherever God has me at that time, I'm going to serve him no matter what. Understand that God did not command us to preach the gospel only where we're in and exactly where God wants us. God said preach the gospel everywhere. Preach the gospel everywhere. Preach the gospel everywhere. I mean, hopefully you're not on vacation going, well, you know, someone asked me about salvation that I just met, but I can't talk to him because I'm on vacation. This is not the will of God. I'm supposed to be in Columbus, Ohio. No, you give the gospel. You be a Christian everywhere you go. You share the gospel everywhere you go. In some reason, we got the mentality that if this is not God's will, then I don't have to serve him here. I'll just wait till I get there, and then I'll serve him there. No, you got to serve God wherever you're at. Understand this. Wherever God has placed you now, look at it as that's his will right now. So I'm going to serve him where I'm at now. I'm not going to wait. I'm not going to, I'm still praying about what God wants me to do. Some of you are still praying about getting involved in the bus ministry. Stop praying about it and just get involved. We use that excuse way too much, right? Baptists, we pendulum one side to the other. Oh, I got to pray about it. No, don't stop praying about it. Get involved. God didn't say pray about sharing the gospel. He said go give the gospel. Preach the gospel. He didn't say pray. Well, make sure you go pray about preaching the gospel. No, preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. By the way, why are we praying about going on a mission trip? Why are we praying about going to a foreign country and preaching the gospel? God didn't say pray about going. He said, go into all the world, preach the gospel. He didn't say, hey, make sure you pray about going to all the world, preach the gospel. He said, no, go preach the gospel. See, we take things and we overthink things. And God says, listen, it's very simple. I believe if you go to the right hand or left, just serve me. Wherever you go, whatever comes your way, just serve me no matter where you find yourself in life. Just serve me. Just serve me. We've got to understand. We've got to stay in tune with God. We've got to stay in tune with God. It's hard for God to show us direction. It's hard for God to help us in where we are at in our life when we don't stay in tune with him and stay in our personal walk with him and listening to the Holy Spirit and what he wants for us. We have to stay in tune with God. Another example we can learn from Abraham is not only to stay in tune with God, but decide that wherever and whatever direction life goes, I'll serve God anyway. There's many people in this church right now that you did not see your life where it is right now, good or bad, years ago. You had no idea. You didn't know that was going to happen. You didn't know that would be something you carried for the rest of your life. Think of a brother Chris back here that got an illness. They still don't even know what it is. He had no idea that was coming. Busy serving God. And then, boom, he's hit with something. He doesn't know. Guess what? He still serves God. He said, well, I guess I can't, serve anymore because now something happened in life that I did not expect. And if there's someone that schedules and plans, it's him right there. We have a joke. Well, I think we have a joke. And I'm going to tell it as a joke. And when we send text messages back and forth, I reply with like one or two words. That's it. And every time, especially to the kids as teenagers, they're like, did your dad get my text? Yes. There wasn't really no explanation in it, but you got the text. And I said, okay. And that's all you need to know. And that's all but he plans and schedules. When that happened in his life, he didn't allow it to stop him. He just found other ways that I can serve God. Brother Usher, still leading people to the Lord. Outside of coming to church, I don't know if he really gets out of the house. But he's still leading people to the Lord. He didn't allow something that came his way to say, well, that deters me from doing God's will. No, he decided whatever comes my way, whether it's the right hand or the left hand, I'm just going to serve God no matter what. Whatever I face. Christian, what are you facing? So I'm not facing anything. Then what is going to stop you from serving God? Because there's something coming that's going to try to stop you from serving God. There's something along the road of life that you're going to face. That you're going to have to decide, right hand or left, I got to continue to serve God. Me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. No matter what we face, we'll do what's right. I think of, I love sports, and we watch a lot of sports, and I love it, okay? But I think of sports. When there's a team that's out there, whether it's basketball, hockey, or whatever the sport may be, when there's a team that is out there and they have a game plan, they have practiced and practiced and practiced, and listen, they've watched film and watched film and watched film and watched film, trying to study their opponent and know what they're going to do and when they're going to do it, what to look for, signs, all these things, you know, they're trying to plan. So they get out there. And about 10 minutes in, they realize it ain't working. They're throwing something at us that we haven't seen before. What do they do? Just, all right, coach, we give up. We haven't seen this. We didn't practice enough. The bench is right there. Let's just give up and go back. No. And the coach gets down with that board and says, hey, guys, listen, okay, here's what they're doing. Here's what's going on. We're changing everything up. We're throwing our whole entire week of practice out the window. We got to change everything. And they change it on the spur of a moment because of what they're facing. Now, they do that in sports. Why can't we do that in the Christian life? When things do not go as planned, and man, our dreams are not going to happen now. It totally got changed around. Did not see that coming. Why don't we just give up and go sit on the bench? Instead of saying, God, whatever happens, we're just going to continue to serve. Stop allowing the direction of others, listen to this, in the failure of others to determine your future. Listen to me, Christian. Stop allowing the direction of others and the failure of others to determine your future. You decide, no matter what takes place, I'm going to serve God. No doubt Lot and everything that happened to his family from there on after hurt Abraham. That's his family. But did Abraham say, no, God, I'm not giving my son. No, God, I'm not serving you anymore. I'm done. No, it hurt. It hurt. It was unexpected. It was somebody else's failure. No doubt it was embarrassing as a child of God. But he continued to serve God. He continued to be and do what he was supposed to do. Number three, understand that others must answer for themselves, but I must answer for God. Abraham had to accept, Lot, you're your own person. Right hand or left? Which one do you want? The whole land is before you. Right hand or left? Separate himself. Let's not fight anymore. I'm done with it. Let's not fight anymore. Lot, you choose. Left hand or right hand. Whatever you choose, I'll do the opposite. I'm still just going to continue to serve God, and you do your own thing. I'm going to continue to serve God. Listen, understand that others, they must answer for themselves. But you got to answer for yourself. You got to answer for yourself. How many parents, good families in church that we have seen just walk out on God because of a child? I mean, and not even just little, I mean, embarrassing stuff. I mean, used to do this, but now all of a sudden you do that. Have you ever seen somebody you hadn't seen in a while and you didn't recognize them? Oh, yeah. The whole dress, everything changed. Their attitude, the way they look, you didn't even recognize them. You saw them and you thought, oh, boy. Oops. You thought, oh, boy. Huh, what does that mean? You remember when they were in church. You remember when they were doing right. You remember what they were, the way they acted and the way they were and their attitude and their spirit. And then you see them a year later, 2 years later, a decade later, and it's like, what happened? Listen. They have to answer for themselves. And Abraham had to realize that no matter, I love Lot, I love my nephew. I love him dearly, but I can't follow him. I can't worry myself with him. I've got to continue to serve God. Look at verse number, let's read further down. Verse number 14. Genesis chapter 13 and verse number 14. And the Lord said unto Abraham, after Lot was separated unto him, lift up now thine eyes and look from the place where thou art northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Arise, walk through the land, in the length of it, and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto thee. And Abraham removed himself, removed his tent, and came and dwelt in the plain of Mamre, which is in Hebron, and built there an altar unto the Lord. Understand that after Abraham decided, God, this is crossroad decision time. I'm going to serve God no matter what. Whatever direction you place me in, whatever way and you, whatever you allow in my life, I'm still going to serve God. Right? Then the blessings of God started coming again. I wonder how many people in our ministry, Anchor Baptist Church, have been at that crossroad for years. And God is just waiting for you to make that decision. I have all these plans for you. I want to use you for the ministry. But you got to make the decision. Which way are you going to go? Is he going to stay there and never make a decision? Or are you going to choose? Yeah. Left hand or right hand? Are you going to decide that whatever you face, I'm going to continue? Wonder how many people were faced with a crossroad in their life, a struggle or a temptation or a problem in their life, and they literally threw their hands up and said, God, I can't do this right now. And they're still standing there. God's saying, until you make this decision, I can't bring you any further. I can't show you my will and my plan until you make that decision. What if Abraham said, no, Lot, we're going to stay together. We're going to figure this thing out. We're just going to stay together no matter what. Yeah. Would God have revealed to him his plan? Would we be able to say if Abraham is a friend of God? Would we be able to say, know all these things and say that he was a man of faith? Abraham, man of faith. Would we have the examples? We'll talk about that this morning a little bit, about the examples that we need in our church and examples that we need in our in Christianity. What decision do you have to make? Let me say this. Location should not determine, ready, your love for God. Location should not determine your work for God. Location should not determine your obedience to God or your direction with God. We are to serve God wherever God puts you. Wherever God puts you. It's not a, well, you know, I'm not there, so I guess I don't have to serve. You ready? it bugs me to death when it happens. I can't stand it. But ready? Well, we're not at anchor, so we don't need to go to church. Vacation, ready? You know, that month-long vacation we take, and we don't go to church for a whole month. Well, because we're not at anchor. You mean you're not supposed to forsake not assembling yourselves together? You're not supposed to go to church because we're on vacation? See, today's Christians, it seems like we're taking more vacation to get away from the busyness of the ministry than really for ourselves. It's a break from Sunday mornings. You know how busy those are. We got to take a vacation. And it cannot be during the week. We have to be gone for a weekend. Because, man, if we can be out on a Sunday and relax a little bit on a Sunday, then we're good. Really? See, this is where we're at in our Christianity, that we're trying to find ways out of serving God instead of trying to find ways to serve God. Our location should not determine our love for God, our work for God, our busyness for God, our direction with God. It should not determine any of that. Our location should just be a location, and I'm going to serve God no matter where I'm at. Abraham had to decide on left hand or right. You choose. And whatever you choose, I'll do the opposite, but I'm gonna serve God no matter what. There's a decision that had to be made. So what about you, Christian? What about you? What decision do you need to make in your own personal life? Maybe no one knows about it. But it is a crossroad that you've been at for years. It's a crossroad you've been at for weeks. It's a crossroad that you've been at in your life, in your family's life. And you just not made that decision to say, God, whatever you bring my way, this or that. Life's but a vapor. I don't know what tomorrow's going to hold. But this or that, God, I'm serving you no matter what. Left or right, Lot, choose. I'm still going to serve God. I don't have to have the well watered plains of Jordan, because I'm still going to serve God no matter what. Abram did not allow the circumstances to determine whether he was going to serve God or not. He said, I'm going to serve God no matter what the circumstances. And so many times in our Christian life, we determine whether we're going to love God, whether we're going to obey God, whether we're going to work for God on the circumstances that we face. Well, it's too hot on the bus on Sunday, so I don't think I can get on the bus. Really? So circumstances determined you serving God. Well, it's too, you know, it's just getting a little cold outside, and so, you know, I just don't go out in the wintertime, starting in, like, September to March. Because it's too cold. So circumstances are determining you serving God. Well, you know, we don't really have nice buses, so I can't be a CDL driver. If we had buses with AC... Brother Ward is like dripping sweat. I'm like, is it raining outside? Nope, not yet, but it's now too. And he's dripping sweat. He's nervous about his hair getting wet today. And he got umbrella. He's like, listen, God bless you. He has this umbrella for these kids to help them get on the bus because it started raining. None of the kids would stare at the umbrella for him. So he's always like, well, I guess I'm just keeping my hair dry, you know. He's just walking back to the bus. All the kids are running. He's like, I guess I got the umbrella for me. And, but no, we allow circumstances to determine our work for God. Well, I'm just tired, you know. I don't think I can come. I'm just tired. It's been a long week. It's been hot all week. We allow circumstances to determine our work for God. Instead of saying, God, if it's a good week or a bad week, I'm still going to serve you. Whether I make the money that I thought I was going to make or don't make the money I thought I was going to make, I'm still going to tithe to you. I'm still going to give to you. whether I get what I think I'm going to get or I don't get what I think I'm going to get, I'm still going to serve you no matter what. Whether I feel like I'm going to get blessings and God blesses an area or he doesn't bless an area, then I'm still going to serve you. Whatever that may be in your life or whatever situation you can apply that to, listen to me, you've got to decide no matter what happens, where I'm at, I'm still going to serve God. What about at home? Let's talk about home. Things at home going not as good as you wish they were? Does that determine you serving God or not? Does that determine you serving God? Well, it's just been a rough week. Really? Really? Rough in American terms is really... You can't compare that to a lot of places. Rough is easy street. Rough is a lot of blessings. But we can't serve God. There's multiple national missionaries that I know. I'm thinking of a couple different ones. Adiwale Adesina and a couple other ones that I know there. And they literally, every Sunday morning, will preach at multiple churches. You ready, ladies? I'm not saying this is lady-like, but this is what they do. But they preach at multiple churches on a Sunday morning, starting early in the morning, in the African heat. Listen to me. And husband, pastor, and wife, with everything they need for each service, will load up on a motorbike and drive from one church to another all Sunday. See, that would completely stop us. Like, I'm not, one, African heat, not doing it already. Don't even care about the bike. Not doing it. By myself, no one else, no AC. Underneath the tree somewhere, not doing it. Nope, not doing it. See, ready? And I'll close with this. Close it. Anchor Baptist Church, what if next week we said, hey, we lost the building, we're meeting out back. We got chairs. I know it's going to be 89 degrees outside. Humidity's going to be up. We're having church. Some of you would look at that like Lot did with the well-watered plains of Jordan and go, no, well-watered plains, if I can have that, I'll take it. But if there's no well-watered plains, I don't want it. Is that our mentality in our Christianity? Ready? If it is, your Christianity is that big. No matter what you say, your love for God is really that big. It's that big. Because we love God and want to serve him as long as everything goes the way that we planned. As long as everything goes our way, we're good to go. But God, we have to make a decision, and you know, I got to give up this or give up that. I got to go to the right hand or the left, and I can't be the one to make the decision. It's got to be made for me, and I just got to accept it. Then we don't want to serve him anymore. We don't want to serve him anymore. From COVID until now, I know multiple churches. Listen, I want to think the blessings of God and ask yourself, could we do this? Could we do this? I want you to ask yourself that. I know multiple churches right now, and one of them is still hopefully getting soon. But I know one church in Florida and one church in Louisiana. Now, Louisiana can get pretty hot. Florida can get hot, too. But Louisiana can get hot, and the bugs are ridiculous. All right? Like, it's just nasty hot. And then Florida is just hot. Like, you walk out, it feels like someone has a blanket over your mouth. You can't breathe because there's so much humidity. Okay? I know two different churches, one in Florida and one in Louisiana, that during COVID, when a hurricane hit, they lost their entire building. And for 2.5 years, they held church, ready, underneath a tent. All year round. In the wintertime, they had heaters. In the summertime, they had fans that didn't help. Metal chairs. A tent. 2.5 years in Florida. I know another church in Louisiana is a friend of mine that I know from going to camp years ago. It's amazing how you still know people from camp when you were a teenager. Their church burnt down in a forest fire. And they're just now got the plans to build the new building. They've been in a tent for almost 3.5 years. Every Sunday, having church. Every Sunday, praising God. And every Sunday, people getting saved. Let me ask you this. If that was the decision God had for Anchor Baptist Church, would you be in church on Sunday? If God said, I'm going to take everything from Anchor Baptist Church and you're starting all over, would you be in church? Would you still tithe when there's nothing really to tithe to? Huh. Thought about that. Would you still tithe? Would you still give? Would you still obey God when you say everything was just taken? See, we are more concerned about, no, God, I don't want to leave my country and my family and the location where I'm at. I'm too comfortable here. I don't want to leave that. Well, then, Christian, let me tell you something. Listen to me. Then you'll never know the blessings of God. Like those that step out on the water when Christ says, come on out. You'll never know the blessings of God. You'll never look back in your life and say, look at these great and mighty things that God did. Because that, listen, that testimony takes faith. God, whatever direction you take us, we're going to serve God. Whatever direction that you allow in our life and whatever I face in life, whatever decision has to be made, no matter what, I'm still serving God. I'm not moving, not wavering from it. I'm still serving God. So what about it, Christian? Left hand or right hand? Left or right? What are you going to do? What decision are you going to make, husband? Man? What decision are you going to make, wife? Church member, what decision are you going to make? We've gotten away from living our Christian life on what God wants and what will happen in eternity and more about what's comfortable for me. When we ask, hey, we need help in this area. Hey, we need finances. We need help. We need to get this. We need to purchase this. This broke. Our first question in our mind, if we're honest, our first question is, can I afford it? Would I be inconveniencing myself to help? In a ministry, in finances, in whatever need a church has, our first question is always about, what if we change that around and we say, okay, God, everything that is asked, my first question would be, what can it do for God? What can it do for Him? What can it do for Him? Some of you gave a lot of money towards food bags. I'm excited about that. Are you willing to inconvenience yourself one Starbucks coffee for a week of food in Honduras? See, we're not. No, you know, I got to be comfortable. I got to have everything I need. No, we've got to decide whether we're going to serve God or not. And whatever God brings our way and whatever He asks of us, we've got to be willing to say, okay, it's time to, it might not be the well-watered plains, but we're still serving God. Listen to me, as a church and as a family, left or right, what will you decide? Dear God, I pray that you bless this evening.